General to present the risk management on the project of high-speed rail project between KL to Singapore. Okay, just introduction a bit about the project. This project has been announced by the National Prime Minister, which is Dato' Sri Najib, in December 2010, and is proposed to the to connect between Penang, Kuala Lumpur, and Johor Bahru to Singapore. Okay, on February 19, 2013, Singapore and Malaysia have officially agreed to build a high-speed rail in between Kuala Lumpur and Singapore that to be finished between in the middle of 2020. Okay, so we go to the first slide in terms of risk management. I will explain in terms of this project. I'm going to look at this four step, which is step one of identification, step two, analysis of quality and consequence, step three, risk mitigation, and lastly is control and implementation. So we go to the first one, is step one is identification. After reading through about this high speed rail project, I managed to identify certain risks that are going to be some going to give impact to this project. We're going to look at the financials, technicals, commercial, execution, and contractual or legal. Okay? So for the financials, this project has been announced, officially announced on 2013. Therefore, on 2013, that time our currency is still in a stable currency. Now it's 2016, when all the fuel price go up and down, so it's giving an impact to our currency. So for sure, this is going to be a risk for this project. This project has been declared in the budget 400 billion ringgit in Malaysia. So that might 400 billion, this might be enough for this project, but now it might be too less, or which is not enough for insufficient to handle this project. Okay, we go to the technical. Okay, lack of expert. Because this high speed rail is the first one that Malaysia is going to develop. Previously, this high speed rail usually only available in a developed country like Europe, Japan, where they have all the expertise in terms of building it and construction for the rail. However, for Malaysia, this is our first time where we're going to use the high speed rail. Okay? So for the next one is the commercials. Okay. They believe that when they're able to launch this project, it's going to help the public transport market, whereby it's going to encourage people from Singapore to travel in Asia using this train instead of using air or land. So it is going to be really accepted by the consumer or we as a user of the public transport. Because currently we have seen a lot of competition between the public transport itself, where they are giving a very competitive rate in the air or land. So even now we can fly to Singapore, it's only around maybe 45 minutes with a price less than 100. So this commercial risk is going to be is after the project complete. Is it going to be really being useful by the customer itself? Okay, then we go to the execution, whereby it's geographical factor. Okay, Malaysia known with a very wealthy land where we have a lot of land here and there. We have a river here and there. There is some part which is a rural area where there is no development or electricity. It's not electricity, mostly it's a forest. Okay? Then this geographical factor means here is in order to build this high speed rail, is there really going to be an electrical supply for certain area for this rails? For this rail to be used later. Okay, that's one of the risks that this project is going to have. Another one is contractual or legal, whereby it's going to be a political interest. Okay, the risk is like this project has been announced by our current Prime Minister, whereby another few years we're going to have another So this project when you have this kind of risk, if our prime minister is changing, it's also giving an impact. Why? Even though this contract or this project has been announced with a sufficient amount of budget, 400 million, it might be changes after we have a different leader later. Now we go to step two, analysis of probability and consequence for the project itself. Okay, we go to the example of risk debt. As you can see, I put some four examples, which is an equal failure, budget offer or reduce, okay, or cut, market risk, political risk. Okay, then after identifying it, you can see where I put the chemicals in this sequence of how this going to impact the project itself. So we go to the A technical failure, whereby I believe likelihood to happen is only a medium, okay, but it's going to give a big impact. That's why it's a medium. Okay, then we go to the B, which is a budget over or cut. For the B one, likelihood to happen is only a medium range, okay, because it's already been mentioned that the budget is 400 million, but and then the consequence is also in the medium. So if the plan, the project is going smooth as what they plan, there will be no high risk for this. Okay, then the market risk I'm putting in is high for likelihood to happen in consequence, because even now we have a lot of other public transport offered to the consumer. Even we have Uber, we have train, normal train, we have air flight. Still, lack of consumer willing to travel using public transport. So might be this train also going to give a certain impact. After, is it going to be profitable to the government or not? Okay. Then political risk, I put in yes and no, but it still has the high of consequence. In order to happen is, it might be going to have the same prime minister after this, or it might be changes, but it might be even be changed, but this project will not be impact at all. Okay? So we go to step three. This is a risk mitigation. This is some of the risk mitigation that I can see what this project can do. It's like an asset. For nature to do this project, the risk, they can accept it as a challenge, whereby everything has their first time. So this might be it's the first time for a nation to take this challenge and accept all of it and face it with the budgeted amount that we given to do this project. Okay, then minimize impacts like the control. How they can minimize it? Maybe they can do some improvement for the current rail track that they already have instead of they building a new one. So it's been they improvise it, okay, instead of doing a new rails. Okay, then the third one is share for a partnership of the project. What I mean share in here is this project is going to be more to country, which is major and smaller. So it might be this risk can be shared both country. Both parts are giving their goals where they want to share any risk that going to happen, they going to face it together. Instead, we going to face it by ourselves. Okay? Then transfer is like a third insurance where they totally going to hire to third party, where we going to find a consultant, we going to find a contractor already well known about this, but it's going to the budget for sure. Okay, then lastly is a cross training whereby we can send our team member to prepare with a well-known manager who already has done or already has experience doing this project. This might be we do take a consultant but not for all part. Maybe it's just a certain part in terms of managerial. So we would prepare the team member. So both of them going to learn each other in terms of this. So between these five, I think the most is we can do is we can share. Whereby both country, because this project also will give benefit for both country, because it's going to give social economy